and the power of we are ready for our team.
Openness and cooperation between our BRICS countries. I hope this continues and we will do our best to support this. Thank you.
will you tell us something about our, your French society, its incoming, our French process?
Здравствуйте, все всем. Я не должен выступать, но...
You have your edition. That's why I give...
Дело в том, что Дина Шейсманды очень правильно описали этот зрение, сказал, он... Это он процесс. И тоже как-то соучастники этого процесса. Грит это один из лучших организаций, который сейчас формирован, еще будет улучшаться. И там не только экономические, естественно, любой организации должен быть все экономические, культурные. Мы больше относимся к его отделению, его даем этот вклад на культуру. Очень важно, а не только, что объединяет только все БРИКС, это мы точечные российско-индийские отношения не смотрим, потому что это более, я думаю, такие более должны быть. Мы можем дискутировать о БРИКСе, но я, наша организация США цельна на российско-индийской дружбе, экономической связи. И самая большая цель один из языков БРИКСа это хинди, который мы продвигаем, который мы постараемся продвигать Ринзутан Самадж в России. Делаем все, что для интересно. Кстати, я предложил, что такое язык. Вот ребята наши студенты здесь учатся, ну, в разные вузы, в Казани, Санкт-Петербурге, Владивостоке. Сейчас мы придумали делать знания хинди, как вы знаете. Но невозможно, сейчас век интернета. И хотим через наши связи делать это знание, проверить или в базе РГГУ, или МГУ, или МГИМУ, и одновременно все участвовать будут в этом конкурсе. Это благодаря интернету. Потом мы вручили и вручаем премию «Хинди Ютин Саман». В этом году мы выбили с поздравлением нашего посла два премии. Один имени Александра Кадакина, «Хинди Ютин Саман», другой «Хинди Ютин Саман» имени доктор Ману. Это будет вручено и определено, кто будет получать с помощью культурного центра. И день не делился. И, естественно, мы участвуем вседневные культурные программы российской страны, индийской. Поэтому это вот наш вклад, который, я думаю, эти мелкие или там региональные ассоциации тоже дают какой-то вклад в укрепление БРИКСа. Спасибо.
Спасибо. Мы хотим спросить вам его еще. Вы не интервьюсе?
Такой тип это редко, но это специальный вид, который мы очень приезжу нашего премьер-министра. И, естественно, мы квартально пускаем журнал «Рейнджика». Поэтому это один из тот вклад, который мы делаем для продвижения языка. И это очень важно. А я хочу сказать, что я просил нашему послу, посольству и всем чем, что ребята учатся, надо какое-то, наше должно быть, мы должны продвигать это, найти им работу. Это всегда первые ходят, потом они верят, что они найдут где-то. А так, поэтому это наша душа, все души, которые с помощью Индры, мы создаем такой портал, будем создавать, где мы будем всегда для них работать. Интересно. Но это очень важно. Они к чему учатся, и какой предмет, который знаешь, что в будущем будешь верить, и ничего не будешь.
Спасибо. Mr. Yashmirsin, who is president of Hindustan Samaj.
Russian government which was automatically casted on the Russian government TV channel, TV Kanal. I'm very thankful to Professor Alexander Staryarov, who asked me to share my work experience on the 21st International Economic Forum held in St. Petersburg. That was held on June 1st to 3rd, 2017. In Prime Minister Narendra Modi attended the forum as a guest of honors and also addressed the forum. India was the guest country for the forum. High Indian profile delegates participated in this forum and signed valuable contracts to strengthen the economic as well as industry cooperation between both countries. I hope all respected guests were already aware of the main highlights of SPIF's St. Petersburg International Economic Forum 2017. In a few minutes, I would like to share with you my work area and experience work in SPIF. In SPIF, I work as an interpreter with Mr. Devi Shankar, Secretary of Government of India for Heavy Industries, and with his team as a part of Indian Embassy to Moscow. It was a great experience to work with him. We visited the Krylov State Research Center, formerly named Krylov Shipbuilding Research Institute. It was founded in 1894, and it was a great experience for me to visit huge shipbuilding institute. Till that, I worked with smaller manufacturers like tractor. At this Krylov Institute, we met and worked with brilliant Russian intellectuals. After that, we visited Rosatom. Rosatom State Atomic Energy Corporation in India. Machine building training program has been launched by Russian State Atomic Energy Corporation. Rosatom jointly with state-run Heavy Engineering Corporation Limited, HECL. Sites are developing machine building strategies for further development in India. Along with this, future development has been progressed in the field of nuclear energy by Russian counterpart Rosatom, the builders of the Kudankulam nuclear power project in Tamil Nadu. In SPIF, the main attraction was Make in India stand in Expo Center. It was unique in its own way, comparatively to other stands in terms of design and colorfulness, along with the traditional Indian snacks, the kuski and rich aroma tea. Mrs. Nirmala Sitaraman, the former Minister for Commerce and Industry, she also visited SPIF 2017 and contributed a lot in strengthening business for both the countries. She met Ms. Tatiana Valovaya, Minister of Integration and Microeconomy, at the Make in India launch. Mrs. Nirmala Sitaraman has been, as you know, recently appointed as the Defence Minister, the first woman to hold this position. So I would like to stop myself here and thanks you once again for giving me the opportunity to speak on this occasion. Thanks you all for attentively listening to me. Especially thanks to Professor Alexander Staryarov, Indraji, who asked me to share my work experience. Thank you. Thank you a lot.
Try to keep Indians closer and strengthen friendship between India and Soviet Union then and Russia. The main field of our activities is cultural activities. Hindustan is Mars, celebrating Independence Day of India, Republic Day of India, and other festivals like Diwali, Holi, and organizing meetings with writers and other artists who came to Moscow from time to time. This year we are celebrating 60 years Diamond Jubilee of Hindustan Samaj. But the last two or three years after the demise of the president of Hindustan Samaj, Padma Shri Madanlal Nehru, we started a competition, translation competition among students of Russian universities and institutes who study Hindi translation. We translate from Russian into Hindi, Russian. So this year we organized third competition in March. Last year, for the first time, we organized a very grand gala concert, which was called Unity in Diversity, in which representatives of all states from all corners of India show their cultural experience. So what type of culture in this or that state. In this way, we try to show that even though India is different in its culture, but we stand united every day. So this year also, we are going to organize this gala concert in October 29th of October. This year we are trying to show how India were during these decades, 70 years of independence and 70 years of diplomatic relations between India and Russia and 60 years of Hindustan Samaj. So this year we are trying to show how India was getting well during these years, and one state will show one decade, other state will show second or third decade. And in this way, specific way, we will try to show that India stands united today also. And we will try to stress that 70 years of independence and 17 years of establishment of diplomatic relations between Russia and India, also it will show how Russia always helped India during these years and during difficult periods of time. Soviet Union and now Russia always good with India. So thank you very much. Any question, please? Thank you. One thing I wanted to say. Это так как тема у нас сегодня БРИКС.
Да.
Надо было, наверное, на это больше акцентировать.
Потому что вклад России и Индии, в общем, вот те то общество, которое вы представляете, это и есть вклад общий в развитие наших отношений. Пусть не очень такое вот грандиозное, но тем не менее это вклад.
Да, большой подарочка. Если здесь, знаете, что отношения между странами, входящимися в БРИКС, непростые. Непростые. Особенно если взять отношения между Индией и Китаем. Они уже напряжены до сих пор. историки, наверное, если знают, то очень значительная часть индийской территории оккупирована в 1962 году, как сайте, да. Да, и очень большой кусок территории Пакистана отдал, подарил Китаю, тоже на севере, ну, на севере, Кашмир, там на Мирове, да. И часто у нас возникают конфликты с Китаем, Аруначаль Прадеш, да? Вот в связи с этим, меня, конечно, очень этот вопрос волнует, как эти две страны, имея такие проблемы между собой, как они могут работать в Риксе, когда мы хотите вернуться.
This is signed by both heads of the university.
комплект, который дарит документы.
Подпись.
Yes, and stamped. Okay.
Подпись.
Welcome to our family. Now we are together.
Yes.
And I want to have a small gift for you.
Started, and we had
RIC forum started Russia and China. Then in BRICS forum, India, Brazil, and South Africa. These are the forums which were the precursors to the BRICS formation. And the RIC was very important because it brought together these three countries. And Russia played the most catalytic role because Russia was now having very good relationship with China after the long border was settled. The Shanghai Cooperation Organization was formed in 2001. And then Russia had traditional very good relationship with India. So Russia was the bridge that could bring these two countries together. Otherwise, it was very difficult to bring these two countries. And when their orientation were westward, to bring them to a forum which would emerge as an alternative to and try for a new global order, both in political sense and financial sense. Because ultimately, global order is a political order as much as it is an international financial order. Because the IMF, World Bank, all these were used in the 1990s to make structural changes in the economy of countries, minimize the role of the state from welfare functions, and promote the role of free market in these countries. So all these institutions were used to bring about changes which the West wanted. And they thought that is the best system for the growth. So they promoted these institutions. And this is where the international financial institutions that the BRICS have created is so important today. And you know, in 2015, we saw the emergence of new development bank of BRICS, then the contingency reserve arrangement. Even recently, during this China summit, it was brought out that the first project has started, one solar power project in China, the BRICS bank is giving. So the BRICS came about in a very deep political situation where these countries' sovereignties were being violated. Sovereignties were being limited. So every country in the world was not sure how its sovereignty can be reduced in the name of democracy, in the name of human rights. Sovereign states could be pressurized and their sovereignty could be limited. We have seen series after series in Libya, now in Syria, everywhere. Sovereign states, limits are being set by the West. That you may be a sovereign state, you might call yourself a sovereign state, but your sovereignty is limited. We can intervene in the name of human rights, democracy, and so on. So this became a problem area. Then, obviously, the Western expansion, NATO expansion, not into politics, but even into some of these far deeper was already happening into Ukraine, into Georgia. So that also was a problem for Russia, because Ukraine and the crisis ultimately led to Russia facing the sanctions. But that is when you will find politically the BRICS countries took a position instead of criticizing Russia. Please remember, India and China are very, very careful about secessionism and separatism. Because we have this Kashmir problem, China has Tibet and Xinjiang issues, we are very sensitive. Any state being broken up, any state being, some separatism being practiced there or implemented, despite that, National Security Advisor of India at that time, Mr. Menon, said Russia has legitimate interests, and that interest has to be taken into account. And in the United Nations, they did not vote against Russia, they abstained from voting. That was a big message that when the West was putting so much of pressure, everything was at stake to isolate Russia, to punish Russia. And at that moment, for countries like India and China and Brazil and South Africa to stand up and say, no, we don't want to vote against Russia. So they abstained. That was a political statement. That was also, even though they did not support entirely, but that was enough for Russia that its big partners are not going to condemn it. And then obviously, economically, the things moved on. With China, the relationship with Russia has been very good because after the sanctions, Russia has been more or less economically use the word dependent on China to some extent. It's because its market in China has grown, energy market. Chinese money in investment is coming into Russian market. And Russia is now willing to cooperate with the Chinese Silk Road project, that is Belt and Road Initiative, tries to have a free trade agreement between the Eurasian Economic Union and the China BRI. So I visualize a lot of Russia-China relationship bilaterally happening. And this is a sort of compulsion maybe for Russia to move closer east towards east, and in the east, politically two countries could be very close to Russia, India and China. These two countries are very close, but China has a lot of money and capital to invest and a big market to buy energy products and then have pipelines from this region. India's problem is connectivity, India's problem is its limited kind of money to commit externally compared to China. So Russia naturally leans so much on China that today the relationship has grown exponentially, very heavily, energy deals and other investment deals. With India, Russia had traditional friendship, but that friendship was not enough in contemporary time. When you need more innovative ideas, how to access the Russian market, how to invest here. So a different mindset was required, which the 90s was kind of wasted time for us, where we really did not take so much interest in Central Asia or Russia. And so other countries moved in. Europe moved in a big way, then Chinese. So, but now in India there is a very, very strong feeling that this has to happen. We are happy that a lot of, especially in the defense sector, in the space sector, in the nuclear energy, a lot of investments are taking place. Russia has now agreed, two more nuclear reactors in Kulankulam, and it will be a series, will go on, but at least two more immediately will start after two being operationalized. So in certain spheres, niche areas, Russia and India's relationship will grow. But the problem areas are, I also should say a few words about Brazil and South Africa. You see, the BRICS, the movement, a lot of people say why BRICS cannot really be a strong instrument because it's globally spread into many continents. It has no coherence. But certain scholars have written, a region, a regional agency is not necessarily based on geographical proximity. It is not necessary to have a regional agency on the basis of proximity of regions. It can have, a relational proximity, how you relate to each other, and then you feel like a global region. So it can be relational, even if you are distant, removed in terms of distance. So you look at Brazil. Brazil was emerging, after Lula came to power there, questioning, contesting the hegemonic role of US in that region. And there were other countries were coming up. And Russia, after 1990, started taking more interest in Latin America. And Brazil also was changing its orientation, political orientation, away from the US and looking for partners globally among the South. So Brazil was a country which admits the same sort of strategic interest at the global level, not to allow a hegemonic world order, a one-sided hegemonic world order, inequitable in international order, where there is no equality. So that kind of order they also didn't want. South Africa, of course, had a history of fighting apartheid. So there was a natural inclination among South Africans to be closer to South, which had stood by all their struggles with India, Russia, Soviet Union that time. They always were behind the anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa. So these were the countries, and they were leading countries in their regions. Brazil was doing economically very well. Now its situation is not so good, but yet it is the leading economy in South Latin America. South Africa is the leading economy in Africa, and Nigeria, which had some good times, certainly because of decline in oil prices, Nigeria is doing well. South Africa still remains the leading economic power in that continent. So all these leading powers in the continent coming together. And again, Russia is very crucial because Russia is backing all of these countries for permanent membership in the United Nations. Brazil, South Africa, Russia is backing. Only problem with China, which is reluctant to make India the permanent member in the United Nations. The problem in BRICS that I visualize, where Russia also figures in, Russia's too much closeness to China around this two expectations, or two different kind of emotions. One, you expect from Russia as a traditional friend, as a powerful country, it can wield a lot of influence from China and make China behave both bilaterally and in global multilateral forums to support India, all India's interest, wherever India feels very strong, not standing in the way. That is an expectation from Russia